Ambassador of Australia, she was here earlier. Philippine Competition Commission Chairman, Dr. Arsenio Balizacan, Dr. Gilbert Yanto, PIDS, and our visitors from the Australian National University for organizing this particular event. Thank you for inviting me to be one of the resource speakers. Okay, I would be pretty much echoing many of the things that's already. Let me just organize myself. Okay. So I just thought of titling my presentation. That's not the title of my chapter. What does it take to eliminate poverty in 25 years? It's kind of bold, as if there's really a hard rocket science in this, but just to organize my thoughts, the focus of the presentation would pretty much be a path to hopefully eradicate poverty in 25 years. I suppose we have already heard this. We're no longer the Sigma of Asia question mark. And I don't know if that would be sustained. And we want to mention some of the measures that probably would sustain this, that we are no longer the Sigma of Asia. And for the next, it's not working. Yeah, I think we all know this. As you can see, there's really a dramatic increase in the growth performance of the Philippines. In 2016, I think we were third after India and, of course, Laos PDR. But that's really a very dramatic improvement since 2005. And certainly pretty much a big welcome from the past. As you can see that the boom and bust growth performance of the Philippines, we hardly have any luck in the past 4 decades. But since the 2010, as mentioned by Chairman Balizacan, we had a very good growth, 6.3%. And our task really is to where do I point this? Point is here. Okay. Okay. So I will mention about these factors. I think that they have been mentioned already. But the challenge to us is really sustaining this particular growth. I put some numbers there. At least 6%. Per capita income growing at about 5%, we have to really curb down our population growth as well, and poverty eradicated over the next a quarter of a century, hopefully. So, there are hurdles of sustained growth, sustaining that particular growth. And you've seen a version of this graph earlier by Professor Hall. So that's the sector composition of GDP of the Philippines is really quite unique and not compared, certainly different from what's happening in East Asia. As you can see in the particular graph, services is really rising. Well, agriculture we know is going to be secularly declining, but what is really surprising is our industry, manufacturing, has not really been rising as compared to these other East Asian countries. The common pattern there is industry is going up, agriculture is going down, and eventually services is going up and will catch up with industry. That is not our story. And this is what Professor Fabella says as development progeria, premature development, quote unquote development. So we are, our top sector now is services, and but services and agriculture accounts for about 84% of the labor force employed. So the remaining is industry and agriculture, 16%. So the problem with that is, that's the one. The jobs are in the economy are. Manufacturing is generating few jobs, and services offer jobs, But the problem is they are tend to be low value. So in developed countries, services give high quality, high value income for the workers, but not here in the Philippines. So if you look at the labor productivity of the three major sectors, it's industry that is have the highest labor productivity, not services. And the jobs are not there in the industry. And even labor productivity growth, I think service, we have a very low productivity growth by of the services sector. So that is a problem, I think, in our challenge to sustain this growth. And if we compare this with the other East Asian countries, we definitely have a very, very low labor productivity growth compared to our Southeast Asian neighbors. Okay, now moving on in capital, we also have a very low capital formation among East Asian countries. As a percent of GDP, we have the very the bottom of that, about 19% of our GDP. Other countries would have a much, much higher, maybe 5 percentage points higher. And foreign direct inflows, we are also in the bottom still. We had recent gains in the last, since 2012, that has been rising about maybe another 4 billion. But the latest news is we probably would end up $1 billion less again this year. I hope it doesn't slide down back to the $2 billion of the 1990s. We need FDI inflows in order to also lift up that capital formation that I showed you earlier. In terms of cumulative, yeah, we are down below, up below. ASEAN, for example, inflows is about $120 billion FDI. We are only about maybe $3 billion. Oops. Sorry about this. Okay, and exports, we're not relatively very open as a percent of GDP. And especially also imports. So relative to our neighbors, although we have been integrating with the rest of the world, there are still problems in our trade policies, which I will mention. Look at these trade costs. Oh, wow, I'm going up again. Going down. Yeah, this trade costs is a summary measure of what it takes to bring the product to the market. And we have relatively high trade costs as a measure by the World Bank and UNESCO. Just to illustrate, the most important industry in agriculture is rice. And this continues to be a very well protected industry. And it's like iconic because it defines how we want our trade policies done here in the Philippines. Our trade protection for agriculture at least 50% of world prices, and that has a toll on the poor. I think as World Bank estimated that I am sorry about I'm not really very arrow down. Okay. this one. The save, to look at the savings of, if the price of rice fell to the world price, there's a lot of savings for the poor. Now we are at this juncture now of changing that policy because we don't have anymore a waiver from the WTO to maintain quantitative restrictions. But we're not organized yet to make that happen, to give this to the poor. And it is not so good because that's so? Okay. Well, remember the structural sectoral transformation. Industry and manufacturing are not really kicking because wage costs can be high if food costs are high. So we really have to do something about agriculture, to improve the productivity in agriculture in order to bring down food costs, in order to put pressure, encourage investments in industry and manufacturing. And, this is just a measure of the efficiency cost of import controls on rice. We are spending at least 36.25 billion pesos a year, in my estimate. And why? For the poor farmers, wrong. The poor farmers are consumers. They are paying also for the high cost of rice. So they're penalized as well, in the sense that the cost of rice is high. And yes, we need to increase productivity in agriculture. There cannot be a good industrial development without a strong agriculture. But then we need investments in agriculture, and we cannot have investments in agriculture if there are still restrictions in land markets. Thanks to everyone. Thank you. I think relative to other countries, we're also spending relatively low on social protection, education, infrastructure also, and especially health. Health. Dr. Lianto and I just have a policy note going to come out on medicines. They have lowered medicine prices. Yes, it is lowered, but then the poor can still afford the medicines. We need to get government to invest more on universal health. So those are just the challenges we have to sustain growth. But we remain too cognizant of the fact that that growth may not be inclusive if we don't address this particular problem of poverty, which is still relatively high, about a fifth in our last count of our population are poor. And if you look at the regions, most of the regions are above the poverty average of the country index. So many of us are poor. So if we had growth over the past 10 years or 6 years, then we have certainly not accomplished yet translating that growth into lower poverty. We definitely need the jobs. We still have relatively high unemployment and underemployment, and good quality jobs. And something like this, I think this is kind of come from the World Bank, about a million jobs each year. About maybe half of that will be, a quarter of that may be going abroad, a quarter of that may be absorbed in the formal sector, including the BPOs, and what remains in the industry. But then the remaining will be in the informal services market, which has low productivity and low income and unemployment. Income inequality is high, and it is important in reducing poverty, as this research from FOSU, as you can see, how income inequality can actually influence 34 countries that reduce poverty have sharper reduction of poverty with income growth compared to those that did not reduce income inequality. So I think we need to sustain growth as well as reduce income inequality. So I did some number crunching using a general equilibrium model of the country and have some assumptions about capital and labor productivity growth, like something like investments would grow at an annual rate of up to 10% from the current of 4.64, and labor productivity growing up to 3.71. These are numbers comparable with Vietnam and China. So if we did that, we could have the kind of trajectory of the national per capita income of the country growing to 11,000 from the current 3,500 in about 25 years. Certainly, I think it's good to look forward to. And how about poverty? So there are several scenarios here. The upper one, the black one, is not doing anything, business as usual, same inequality, and you certainly still have, after the 25 years, have a big poverty problem. And but we could certainly bring it down, eradicate. I mean, we may, if we do some of the reforms that we mentioned in the volume. And those two middle graphs there are, one is strong GDP per capita, and the other one is weak. The difference between the two is income inequality is brought down with weak. But if we bring down income inequality as well as do the reforms so that we can have strong growth, then we could eliminate poverty, hopefully in my computation, in 2030. I think I end there saying that if we did this thing, it's possible for us to meet the aspirations of our people as documented in a survey by NEDA. And I think with a vibrant economy and an efficient and responsive government by 2040, Filipinos can afford the kind of life